God, praise God. Let the people of God say amen, amen. I welcome you to The Bread Broadcast, a weekly Bible teaching program from Eternal Food Evangelistic Organization, where we exalt, we edify, and we challenge believers to the Great Commission. Here, we also call people to repentance through the gospel of Jesus Christ. Thank you for joining us. Today in our Christmas series, remember we started 3 weeks back with Jesus as our case study, a successful spiritual personality. And then we did Virgin Mary last week in a free world. So today we are going to be doing how to be God's instrument of greatness. How to be God's instrument of greatness. And of course, our case study, you can guess, is going to be Joseph. I love to call him Joseph the Carpenter, because we have more than one Joseph in the Bible. And the short reading, which is your homework, for this week is going to be Matthew chapter 1, verse 19 to 25. The Gospel according to Matthew, chapter 1, verse 19 to 25. I have read it, okay? Because I don't want to be called out for hypocrisy by the Holy Spirit. So I have read it, so you go read it too, okay? And our foundation text is going to be 1 Corinthians, the epistle of Apostle Paul to the Corinthians, chapter 1, verse 27. We stop at 29. It's a bit of a long read. 1 Corinthians 1, 27 to 29. But God has chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things which are mighty. And the best things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. And the things which are not, to bring to nothing the things that are. That, I love this, no flesh, that is no individual, should glory in his presence. Amen. How did Joseph become God's instrument of greatness? We are going to look at, I believe, four things that happened or that Joseph did that made him God's instrument for greatness. Number one, he was merciful. Joseph, although hurt, still didn't want Mary to be exposed that she's pregnant before their wedding. To do so would have cost Mary her life through sentence of death. That's the way it used to happen in the Middle East, folks, by stoning. And it stemmed from the law of Moses, the Mosaic law. So Joseph planned to excuse himself out of that relationship secretly, you see. One of God's foremost attributes by which he calls himself is merciful. When Moses said, God, show me your glory, God said, you come and stand by the cleft of the rock beside me. I will make all my goodness to pass before you. You cannot see my face, because if you do, you will die. But after I'm gone, you can see my back. And the Bible says that as God was passing by, there was smoke, earthquake, and all that going on. As God was passing by, he was proclaiming himself, the Lord God Almighty, merciful and kind, you see. So one of his foremost attributes is God the merciful. A vindictive person can forget the idea that God can use them as an instrument for greatness. Listen up. If you are vengeful, You remove my tooth, I'm going to remove your tooth. You slap me, I will slap you. You hurt me, I'm coming back for you. If that is your modus operandi, listen up. It doesn't matter how much you think you love Jesus. It doesn't matter if you are the bishop of your church. God cannot use you. Because God is merciful. Now, unless you change, unless you repent, if you want to continue in your vindictive, vengeful attitude, forget it. If God should choose a vengeful person as his instrument for greatness, he will be breaking his own principle, you see. He's a forgiving God. But before he says forgiving the iniquities, he says I'm merciful, you see. So if you are not merciful to other people, you don't know what they've done to me, Joseph and Zion. Yeah, I don't, but God does, you see. And God said, vengeance is mine. So give it to God. Give it to God. Some people are still stuck in 25 years ago because somebody did something bad to them. Look at how many years you've wasted, huh? Give it to God. I promise you, he can deal with them than you can, you see. So Joseph was merciful. And he wasn't ready to do tit for tat, as they say. Let's go to the book of Proverbs, chapter 3, verse 3. It's a very popular verse. A Bible student is saying that right now. Proverbs 3, 3. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the table of your heart. That is, write it on your heart. Don't forget it, you see. To show mercy to others is to sow mercy for later. Joseph and Zion, say that again, because somebody who has been hurting for the past 20 years needs to hear that. To show mercy to others is to sow mercy for later. Listen up. Give it up. Okay? Give it to God. They're not worth your energy. Let God deal with them. Forgive them. Show mercy. Amen? The second thing that Joseph did, he was fearful. Now, Joseph was told the truth about Mary's immaculate conception when the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, you see. Joseph showed reverential fear of God. We are not talking, ooh, God is coming. No, that's not the kind of fear that we are talking about. The Bible says the fear of the Lord is clean in the book of Psalm 19, you see. So there's no torment in love. So the fear of God, it doesn't have torment. It doesn't have it doesn't have any negative to it, okay? So we are talking reverential fear of God through his obedience to what the angel of God told him. Listen up. Please come close. God can be patient with the ignorant, and God can be patient with the spiritually blind individuals. Listen up now. But not with the defiant. Oh no. Why? Because that was the same thing that happened to Lucifer to become the devil, you see. Satan, well, Lucifer, God didn't create Satan. He created Lucifer, okay? Lucifer used to be an archangel. He saw the spiritual truth. He knew the beauty and the power of God. He had all these things going on for him and still went ahead to disobey God, defy God. And that's how he became Satan. So if you are defiant, having been shown the truth of the gospel of Jesus, God has shown himself to you through preaching, through nature, or by helping you when you needed help and you didn't even believe in him, and you say, God, if you can just help me, and he helped you, and you still going in your defiance against God, doing things your own way, listen up. You are running out of time. Oh, yeah. You are running out of time. God will never choose a rebel as his vessel of honor. And this is not only for unbelievers, even Christians, believers, disciples of Jesus Christ. If you are defiant, if you are rebellious, God has been telling you to leave that job for something different, and you are going, God, I've got mortgage to pay, I've got car to pay. God, do you know how much that will cost me? Listen up, you are running out of time. God will take you to the woodshed, and he will deal with you as his child. If you are rebellious, he will deal with you. Although he may use a defiant person as an example for others to learn from. A popular example that comes to mind would be Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. In the book of Exodus, you see, he was an unbeliever. He asked Moses to pray to God. He repented. And when God healed him of that plague, he went back again and sinned against God until God destroyed him and his army. Fly to the book of Acts in the New Testament. Ananias and Sapphira, these were members of the first century church. They were believers. They were disciples, genuine Christians. And they died because the husband lied to the Holy Spirit. The wife came a few hours later. She continued the lie. And they were struck dead on the spot as an example, you see. So the only thing God can use a defiant person for who doesn't fear God is to use them as an example so that others will learn. If we fear God, please listen to this chain of actions. We will obey him. When we obey God, that will be honoring him. When we honor God, we will live a life of holiness, you see. These cannot be separated. No. Some people will say we are under grace as New Testament believers. Agreed. 100%. We are no longer under Mosaic law. 100%. So I can do what I like. No. No. If you indeed are saved and you have the Holy Spirit in you, you will fear God. And to fear him is to obey him. And when you obey him, you are honoring him. And to honor God, that means you'll be living a life of holiness. You will hate what God hates. You will love what God loves, you see. Joseph displayed all these qualities. Failure to obey God in actions displays the true state of our heart toward God. And this is why God's judgment is based first and foremost on the condition of the heart, the motive. You see, when you are doing something, God won't be clapping for you. Say, oh, look at that, my child. She's donating such and such amount to the work of the gospel, or sending us this and that to the missionaries. No, God is looking at your motive, your heart. Why is she doing that? Why is he doing that? Is it to honor me or to show off? You see, the heart is very, very important. Let's go to Proverbs chapter 16, verse 6. Proverbs 16, 6. In mercy and truth, you see, they are always connected together. Atonement is provided for iniquity. And watch this. By the fear of the Lord, one departs from evil. You see, if you don't depart from evil and you say you fear God, you are lying and you are deceiving yourself, not God. But that can change. To honor God in our lives is to conquer wrath in our lives. I am going to say that again because it's so beautiful. If you honor God in your life as a child of God, you won't have the rot of sin in your life. To honor God in our lives is to conquer rot in our lives. Moving on. Joseph was faithful. So he was not only merciful, he was not only fearful. Now we are talking, he's faithful. He was faithful. Listen, a flaky and an unstable person cannot take any major part in God's plan. Forget it. Unless such individual is willing to undergo God's boot camp. Listen, I'm a witness. All right? Shifty, flaky, it's getting too hard, I'm out of here. But when God called me and said, this is what I want you to do for me for the rest of your life, Josephine Zion, all the jobs that you have done, the teaching, office management jobs and all that that you've done in the past, listen, I allowed you to do all that that you wanted. But this is what I sent you to the world to do, to go preach the Bible. I have to be honest with you, I wasn't ready. I was so flaky. But God had to deal with me over and over and over again, you see. And even today, in some areas, he's still dealing with me. Unless you are ready to go through his boot camp, he cannot use you if you're flaky, if you're unstable. Many heroes of faith had to undergo a kind of change so they could walk in the true character or calling of who God had called them to be. For example, Jacob. His name means crook, a crooked Jacob, you see. God had to change his name to Israel, Prince with God. Rahab, her name didn't change, but she changed location, she changed jobs. She stopped prostituting her body, you see, and became a member of the Commonwealth of Israel. Jonah, the prophet, he had to go through a paradigm change. God said, go to Nineveh and preach. And he said, that's an enemy nation. God barbecue them, kill them, I don't care. And God had to take him through the ringer in the belly of the fish, and then he changed his mind, you see. This is because faith walk is a fight walk. Joseph's decision brought inconveniences into his life. For example, like he was looking for a place where Mary could deliver the baby when they went to Bethlehem. And then after the baby was delivered, they had to flee to Egypt to escape Herod's execution order that all male boys should be killed, you see. Those were inconveniences to Joseph's life. It was just a common peasant for a carpenter, you see. Joseph proved himself to be a faithful person by not settling down to a normal life as he knew it. He refused to compromise his resolve to walk with God. I like the way Ellicott's Bible commentary put it. Quote, anyone who cannot leave their comfort zone, or anyone who hates to be inconvenienced for the sake of the gospel, is disqualified ipso facto. Because of that very action, is disqualified for the work of the kingdom of God, you see. For the very fact that they don't want to be inconvenienced, they have disqualified themselves to be used by God. End of quote. Such an individual cannot expect any heavenly reward from God. Forget it. God is telling you to adopt a child and bring up that child for his glory. And you are saying, God, that's expensive. We are talking about a soul. You don't know how many souls that child will reach for God. God is saying, reach to your neighbor who is lonely and begin to love on them, to show them Jesus. I don't like that lady. No, God is not saying go like everybody. He says love people. Praise God for that. God has not said like them. No, big difference. If you love them, it doesn't matter how badly they behave or ugly they behave. You want to tell them there's heaven, there's hell. That is love. So Jesus has not called us to love to like people, but to love people, you see. So if you want to be found useful as God's instrument of greatness, you have got to put your personal comfort zone out of the window, your personal conveniences. I like it the way I want it. That has got to go. Let's go to the book of Luke, chapter 9, verse 62. The gospel according to St. Luke, by Dr. Luke, chapter 9, verse 62. But Jesus said to him, this is Jesus, no one, having put his hand to the plow and looking back, is fit for the kingdom of God. Not the kingdom of heaven, which is a location, a place, but the kingdom of God, which is God's actions, okay? Things that God is doing, his work, his mission. If you say, okay, God, okay, I will do what you have asked me to do, and then the next time you are going, that will inconvenience my time. No, I don't want to do that again. God is not going to give you any reward. You disqualified yourself, you see. Let's go to 2 Timothy, chapter 4, verse 10. We stop at 11. This is Apostle Paul talking to his prodigy, Timothy, by the Spirit of God. He said, for Demas has forsaken me, having loved this present world, and has departed for Thessalonica. Church history tells us that Demas came from Thessalonica. So on getting back to his hometown, he saw, and Thessalonica is a metropolis, so he saw all the beautiful stuff there and the conveniences and the comfortable life that he used to live. And he was like, Apostle Paul, see ya, I'm gonna stay here. You see, the missionary journeys have been very rough, so I'd rather stay here, you see. So he left Apostle Paul and stayed in Thessalonica. Only Luke is with me, that is Dr. Luke. Get Mark, John Mark, and bring him with you, for he is useful to me for ministry. Guess what? Dr. Luke, is the one that wrote the gospel according to St. Luke that we read today by the Spirit of God. And Mark wrote the book of Mark. He was described to Apostle Peter, because Apostle Peter was an uneducated man. So he was the one giving the history or the story of their journey with Jesus, and Mark was writing it down. You see, Luke and Mark, who were useful, who were not shifty or flaky, who were there with the apostle in all those rough missionary journeys, we still read about them today. But where is Demas? I don't see any book written by Demas in the Bible. Oh no. You see why? He disqualified himself. To say so and to do so is to glow so in the Lord's robe. Don't you love that? Let's say that again. To say so and to do so is to glow so in the Lord's robe. You see, there's a role in heaven. It's called honor roll of faith. And for everyone who goes through tough times for Jesus, their names are going into that role. All right? So there will be times things will be rough working for God. Maybe as a Bible teacher or in your office, wherever God has placed you, things will be rough sometimes. I'm not going to lie to you. But stick it in there, okay? And just say, God, help me. And God is faithful. He will change your perspective, and then you continue the journey. I love the way Dr. Rogers says, you see, I get tired on the job, but I'm never tired of the job. No, I'm never tired of doing this. Oh no, but I get tired on it sometimes when things are just coming and I'm like, ew. But God is faithful. And after he has ministered to me, I receive strength again and I continue going, all right? Amen. Now, the last thing that Joseph did, he was useful. Every disciple Jesus called was busy doing something, every one of them. Jesus said, I must work the work of him who sent me. That's in the gospel according to St. John chapter 9, you see. God, listen up. Let me say that slowly. God detests laziness. God detests laziness. Joseph assumed full responsibility of being an earthly father for baby Jesus. He worked hard as a carpenter to provide for his family. He was a father figure in the childhood life of Jesus, because by the time Jesus became adult, Joseph was out of the picture, and history says he probably have died, you see. Joseph proved useful in God's great plan of salvation, and his name became intertwined with the life and time of Jesus. I like that word, intertwined. There's no way you can talk about Jesus and talk about Mary and not mention Joseph. No. He became memorialized, you see. Whatever God is asking you to serve him with, if you fail to yield, you are proving unusable for God. Is God asking for your money to be spent to save souls so that people will not go to hell and you are holding to your money? It's not your money, really. God gave you those extra money for a reason. I like the way our senior pastor says it. If God is blessing the ministry, we say, okay, I believe God has a project for the ministry. And it's always like that, you see. So when God is giving you an extra blessing or extra blessings, it's not for you to spend it on yourself. Oh no, there's a divine reason for that. Now, if you hold on to that, you are in trouble as a child of God. Because God wants to use those extra blessings for eternity, for the purpose of saving souls. So if you fail to yield those extra blessings, you are proving to be useless to God. It is not difficult for God to find a replacement. Oh yeah. There are so many people. God can allow a prostitute, an armed robber, to be converted today, and God will equip them so fast, you won't believe it. If a child of God is proving too difficult, God can use anybody, you see. Romans 12:11. I love the New Living Translation for this, and that's why I'm using it. It says, never be lazy, but work hard and serve the Lord enthusiastically, you see. So don't be lazy in whatever God is calling you to do. Is he asking you to use your skills, your intellect, your experience, or your property, or whatever God is asking you to use? Don't hold it back, because we are only here for a short time, okay? Proverbs 18:9. He who is slothful in his work is a brother to him who is a great destroyer, you see. When you are holding resources back and you are not allowing God to use your resources or use you to reach people for the kingdom of God, you are proving to be a destroyer to the work of God. Because those people, they will die in their sins and they will go to hell, you see. God is ready to use a vessel who is ready to be used for his marvel. God is ready to use a vessel who is ready to be used for his marvel. God wants to make something beautiful with your life. He wants to write a beautiful story of the gospel through your life. Don't botch it. All right, what have we done so far? How did Joseph become God's instrument of greatness? He was merciful. He was not vengeful, even though there was no exonerating evidence to prove Mary's innocence. Joseph was fearful. He promptly obeyed God once he was shown spiritual truth. He was faithful. He did not cut and run from the challenges associated with being misunderstood for his obedience to God. He was useful. He assumed full natural responsibilities of being God's human partner in the grand plan of the birth and childhood of Jesus Christ. Now let's conclude. As a believer, are you desiring God to use you greatly or to use you more greatly? Where are you lacking in any of these areas, as demonstrated to us by the life of Joseph? Where? You can still make amends so you can become who God has called you to be and to do what you have been saved to do. Joseph taught me some lessons, I'm telling you. And I'm really working on those things. And I know the Lord will give me the grace so you can also make amends. Now, if you are a non-believer, your starting point is to recognize Jesus as the owner of your life. Surrender your heart to Jesus because he made you. No matter, listen now, if you're a non-believer, a degenerate. It doesn't matter how important you think you are right now. Doing what you are doing right now. You are a CEO of Fortune 500 company, whatever you think you are. There is no remembrance of you or your achievements in eternity. Why? Because you don't belong to Jesus. And that's why the Bible calls pagans degenerates. You see, if Jesus is not in your life, whatever you achieve, whoever you are, it all stops here when you stop breathing. That's it. However, if you want to be forever remembered for fulfilling God's purpose in your generation, you have to give your life to Jesus. And you can start that by clicking on a link that is coming up very shortly. I'm going to pray. Now get out of your face so you can go meet with Jesus on that link and give your heart to Jesus. Let us pray. Father Lord Jesus, we cast ourselves at your mercy. For believers, we ask that you give us the grace to go all the way for you and for the cause of the cross. May we not be useless. May we not be a disappointment unto you, Lord. And for unbelievers willing to give their souls and their hearts to Jesus so they can do something monumental, something eternal in the kingdom of God. Father, give them the heart of understanding. Put the knowledge of your word in their heart. In Jesus' name, have we prayed. Amen and amen. I will see you next week. Only if Jesus has not split the sky open.